Hi folks, this is David Kwan here. So just a couple of days ago, President Obama announced a strategy to degrade and dismantle the Islamic State of Iraq and the Levant. He refers them to as ISIL. It's an extremist terrorist nation-building group more commonly referred to as ISIS or as the Islamic State. Looking at various media clips, I get the feeling that the whole country is galvanizing for some sort of action. You know, some politicians have been tweeting and repeating that something has to be done. Many leaders and pundits of the political right have called for violence in the name of justice, saying that the groups in Iraq and Syria must be bombed, must be killed, must be wiped out. And it's not only the right-wing pundits and media and leaders, but also the Democratic base or the liberal base have been kind of galvanizing and being hawks in this issue as well. And so it's interesting, just 3 years after the United States soldiers have left Iraq, this country, United States, has again formed a coalition of allied countries, which includes countries like France, Germany, UK, Australia, and a couple of other nations, and is again on the verge of starting another prolonged war. To me, this seems so wrong. You know, I can't help but ask, why do we need to go into a war again? This specific war that we've been in for over 10 years. Why use military force in Iraq like this yet again? Why must a huge portion of U.S. tax dollars go into killing a group of people who live thousands of miles away from the United States? And so much portion of revenue that the United States make from our taxes go into the military-industrial complex in this country, which of course funds efforts like this to do military action in Iraq and Afghanistan and what have you. So that's really my question. It's kind of a rhetorical question because you can see that I don't support military action in this manner. Now, I'm sure people who support the current U.S. strategy have their reasons. And in this video, I'm thinking to just kind of list them here and share my honest opinion on those reasons. I'm not an expert in this issue. These are just kind of my thoughts and to have for discussion or whatever. If you want to respond in your own sort of way, I welcome the discussion. You can leave comments below and whatnot. As long as we try to make sure that they're civil. I know this is YouTube, and so comments can get out of hand, but whatever. So, the first reason I usually come to is this. So the first reason, though Operation Enduring Freedom was ultimately a mistake, it is our mistake. The American people have a responsibility to fix the mistake that we made instead of just turning tail and leaving it as it is. So that's one of the arguments, I think. And I think the appeal to a sense of duty and obligation here is misplaced. I can kind of understand it, but you know, I don't think it's a strong rhetoric. Because invading and occupying a different country under false pretenses, if you ask me, isn't merely a mistake. It's had disastrous consequences. Hundreds of thousands of people were seriously hurt and killed in the process. Many were tortured. Many had their family members have bombs dropped on them. The lives of Iraqi people, whether they were actually terrorists or not, many were not, regardless, they were affected by U.S. and its allied nations occupying their country. Consider this analogy. It might be a little off place, but just imagine there's this powerful, muscular guy. He's really strong. He's armed to the teeth. He has guns on his shoulders and grenades on his belt. So picture this, I guess you could call it modern-day Rambo. This Rambo guy, there's this house located very far from Rambo's own neighborhood. But Rambo goes there, he raids it, he enters the house, and he proceeds to just shoot and kill the father of the house. And some of his stray bullets accidentally kills two of the sons of the house. So a couple of people are killed, but the Rambo was targeting specifically the father of the household. Now, the Rambo guy says, you know, he came here because the father of the household was reported to be abusive. And because he suspected there were illegal drugs being smuggled out of this house. So he claims now, you know, now that he's killed the father of the household, he says, oh, you know, now I helped the household and I freed you from the tyranny of your abusive father. And after this, he doesn't go away. He stays in the house and he says, now he will be the father of the household instead, and he will try to make create a leader of the household, from the remaining wives and daughters and sons of the house. The remaining family members of this house can either support him in creating a stable household policies, or they'll be considered as accomplices in the drug smuggling effort that this household has been suspected of from the beginning. So that's, imagine that situation. But now, it actually turns out that the house didn't have any illegal drugs in the first place. So, it's a mistake that this Rambo guy came in here under that pretense. So he changes the rhetoric, saying that, oh no, it was to give you guys stability and peace from your abusive father. The Rambo guy, after having done all this, he doesn't apologize, he doesn't give any excuses, but he continues to give out the rhetoric that he's here to help the people of the household. Just imagine that analogy and ask yourself, should this Rambo guy continue to stay in this house? Should he continue to stay there so he could fix whatever mistake he's made that he's not admitting that he's made? Is it his obligation, his duty, to fix the mistake he caused to this household? Common sense to me says that him continuing to stay in the household only makes matters worse. A mistake was made, but sometimes staying to fix or repair the damage done by that mistake actually does more harm than good. It continues to do harm. When someone rapes a woman, we don't demand that the rapist now has an obligation to make it up to the victim by becoming the woman's assistant. We don't say, hey, you raped that woman, now you must marry that woman and be good to the woman. That's just wrong. The rapist made a mistake, horrible, horrible mistake. We don't even call it a mistake, which is why saying that America invading and occupying a different nation, considering it a mistake, is just wrong on so many proportions. But anyway, that's ludicrous. We don't say that the rapist has an obligation to fix his mistake. No, we, as a society, in a case like that, we make sure that the rapist doesn't get near that woman victim ever again. They are to be separated, to be left alone for, it can be done as long as possible, for forever. And the rapist may also be punished. And hopefully that's what happens. That there is, if the rapist is convicted of a rape crime, that the rapist is convicted, is punished, serves his sentence, and never again goes near the woman that he raped. America raped Iraq. People didn't welcome American soldiers to attack and occupy their country back in 2005. Nearly 10 years later, I'm not sure if Iraqi people welcomes American fighter jets and drones to bomb their country again. Second reason. So, this kind of goes like this. ISIS, or ISIL, is a threat to American security. That's the second reason. I admit, ISIL is a horrifying presence in Iraq and Syria. And increasingly so now in Libya. They're expanding. For any American citizen residing in those countries, Iraq, Syria, and Libya, yes, ISIL is a very serious, very real, very dangerous threat. But for those of us who live thousands of miles away here in the United States, I'm living in New York City, ISIL's cache of weapons and jeeps won't directly affect us. ISIL is concerned primarily with establishing a totalitarian government within their own borders, and then expanding their borders in that region. For people living in America, or for people living in Denmark, Netherlands, whatever, international terrorist networks like Al-Qaeda are still a bigger, more real threat. Right-wing lunatics with their homegrown weapons and their homegrown bombs, they'll do killing sprees. They're still a bigger threat than ISIL. Currently in America, militarized police officers without proper de-escalation techniques training, they're still bigger threats than ISIL in America. Their threat is actually real in America. So, ISIL doesn't actually pose a real serious, harm, dangerous threat in America. What threat ISIL does pose is ideological. What I mean by that is their propaganda has been spread widely and I would, some would say, expertly via social media networks like Twitter and whatnot. And that's had the effect of people from all over the world being recruited to ISIL. Some families in Netherlands and Great Britain and Denmark, so, they're having their friends or their sons or daughters abandoning them to join ISIL. They're just going over to Iraq and Syria to be recruited to ISIL. Now that's the disheartening threat that people here could be so affected, so convinced by the propaganda of ISIL that they're joining ISIL. So that's a serious threat. Unfortunately, this sort of threat, you can't eliminate it with more bombing and more killing. Actually, more bombing and more killing actually make ISIL propaganda efforts more powerful. And thus, ISIL can through that, attain even more support and recruits from around the world. If you look at it, isn't it strange that ISIL is almost egging United States to and the Western powers to attack them? Why are they egging them on? Because it helps the recruitment efforts. Because that's the real threat of ISIL. You know, they say, oh, we need support, as much support as we can get, because all these Western powers are against us and we need to defeat them. This rhetoric becomes more powerful when the United States does bomb the hell out of them, and all those bombs, some of them, like many of them, will accidentally kill civilians. And ISIL is relying on that to be able to recruit even more people. And that's the real threat of ISIL that we're going to be supporting by attacking them militarily. Third reason. So this is the third reason. I'll try to speak in a different voice. Oh, we can't let ISIL grow larger and more powerful. They must be stopped and eliminated now. We need to take military action now before they actually do become an empire that they aspire to be. So that's the third reason. And I actually sympathize with the sentiment of this argument. But again, the question is still, why the United States? Why us? What's essentially going on right now in Iraq and Syria are civil wars. Is Iraq and Syria requesting military assistance from the United States? Are they welcoming American soldiers and fighter jets and drones? Are they just as willing as the United States to fight back and kill and die so that ISIL can be eliminated? Are we being welcomed there, you know, as our military presence? The fact that no one can really give a clear affirmative answers to these sort of questions, to me, that's troubling. And in essence, this is Iraq's war. This is Syria's war. United States does have a role in perhaps giving a support to people suffering under ISIL rule. And I think a good argument can be made for US, along with UN, to offer humanitarian aid efforts and services to the people of Iraq and Syria. Because that would just be counted along as lines of along the lines of international relief effort, and I'm all for that. But war, you know, why United States and 10 other mostly Western countries, none of them Muslim, mind you, why they must use bombs and guns to kill one faction of a civil war that isn't anywhere close to these countries, that's not really clear to me. There's not really any modern historical precedent for this kind of effort being successful. There's no case of, you know, a civil war being successful by a foreign nation coming in and getting involved militarily with one of the side of the civil war not really participating. Korean War wasn't won this way. Vietnam War wasn't won this way. You know, there's no historical precedent of this being successful. Actually, judging by history, United States getting into Iraq militarily will only make things worse. In an effort to stop ISIL, chances are that Iraq will be a land of bloodshed, where lots of people are killed and hurt, and most of the people in that region will hate United States that much more in the aftermath. Even if ISIL is eliminated in that region through US military actions, the political turmoil that's created in the aftermath will cause another politically extremist terrorist group to rise up and challenge the United States. What you're going to have is this cycle of violence that will continue on and on, even after all the tax dollars have been spent and so many casualties have been caused and so many weapons and bombs have been exploded and used. So that's pretty much my honest opinions on this. My conclusion is that before being riled up, before being galvanized to say, oh, we need to bomb them all, we need to attack, we need to act now, before we get our emotions riled up in that manner, we need to be really mindful of what a U.S. military action in Iraq would actually mean. Even if that only entails bombing by drones, that's still a military action. To say, let's bomb them, is so easy to say. But the actual aftermath of bombing and war usually is not such a simple matter. And for people affected by the bombs and the weapons and the war, it's horrible. I think it's really, really important to continue to ask ourselves, why does US need to get involved militarily in Iraq?